Each week, in partnership with the GI Museum in Goshen, we interview veterans of the military about their experiences abroad. We'll air these stories unedited and unchanged. These heroes were there on the front lines and lived through unspeakable horrors to tell us their story. And now, we sit down with a true hero.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Local Heroes, brought to you by WKFK TV7 in Pascagoula and the GI Museum in Goshen. Tonight, our special guest is Mr. C.L. Harvey. He is a Navy veteran and he served on submarines. Mr. Harvey, or Harv as you like to be called, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
And I'd really like to get started with how you got into the Navy or what you were doing just before you decided you were going to join the Navy.
Well, I was fry cooking in a family restaurant there in Rolla, Missouri, on January the 2nd, Sunday evening, right after New Year's. There was no business at the restaurant. Everything was quiet. Everybody was worn out from the weekend. And somebody had left a newspaper there, and I picked it up and looked at it. And down in the lower right-hand corner was a special notice that the Korean GI Bill was going out of effect, effective January 31st, 1955. Well, the next morning, instead of going back to high school, I was a senior, I went to the recruiting office. And it was kind of interesting. The recruiting office was two doors up the street from our restaurant, and all four branches of the service, Army, Air Force, Marines, and Navy, were in there. The three sergeants had all been trying to recruit me. The Navy chief would get me aside and say, hey, wait, you get your education all you can and then come see me. But I walked in there that Monday morning and said, good morning, Sarge, good morning, Sarge, good morning, Sarge, sign me up, chief.
Had you met the recruiters at your restaurant? Is that where you...
Since we were in close, just two doors down the street from them, when they had candidates come in to visit them, they'd give them a chit to come get a piece of pie and a cup of coffee at our restaurant, and then they'd come pick up the chit. So the recruiters were in and out of our restaurant all the time.
So you're familiar
with these guys. So I knew them all very well.
So you signed up?
Signed up, went to boot camp. While I was in boot camp, I was in an all-state Missouri company. We gathered in St. Louis on Monday the 10th of January and went by train to Great Lakes, Illinois, and got there on the 12th, and that's when I was sworn in.
Was it snowing there at Great Lakes?
Oh, Lord, it was snowing all the time, all winter. In fact, 2 hours of our sleeping time every night, we had to go out and sweep snow and make room for us to march the next day. And It was cold, and we had a chief that made us keep our peacoat collars down and our watch caps squared. We couldn't pull them down over our ears. I've come in off of marching with digging ice out of my ears, but that's another story. While in boot camp, I put in for submarine school, and we had to interview with the personnel people. And a third-class personnelman told me that I could not go straight to submarine school without having a Class A school. So I ended up, he offered me three: electronics technician, fire control technician, and communications technician, which were 26, 44, and 52 weeks, respectively, in length. And communications technician, you not only have to learn everything a radioman learns, but you have to learn a foreign language. But I wanted to go to sub school, so I took the shortest one. I took electronics technician and went there. Well, as I'm about to graduate from ET school, I again put in for submarine school. Well, there were quite a few people put in for it, and the training command there, that was again at Great Lakes, the training command said that we can only send 12, and we're going to take them alphabetically. Well, they posted the list, and I was number 13. Mm. I said, oh, no, I'm going to miss it again. But as luck would have it, the guy that was number 12 bilged his final exam, and I got to go.
Bilge for everybody out there that don't know what that means. He didn't pass it.
He didn't pass. So I just skated through and got to go to sub school. Got up there in November 1955, graduated from my sub school class in January, but I had to stay an extra 3 weeks because of my electronics school. I had to stay for 3 weeks of submarine sonar operator school to learn how to recognize different ships and what they were doing. Submarine sonar is different from surface craft sonar because we try not to put any sound out in the water. We just listen to the sounds coming in and try to analyze them. Because every time you put sound out in the water, you say, hey, here I am.
Yeah, so, I know, but sub school, tell us something about, I mean, it's got to be a little bit different than your average ordinary training that people get in the Navy.
Sub school teaches you, at that time, it was all diesel electric submarines. No nukes. They hadn't even, I guess they'd started planning on them, but there were none in service. You had to learn all of the systems aboard the submarine, all of the tank arrangements, all of the air systems, all of the fluid systems, everything about the ship. And you were tested on it. And then you got to go out on sea school submarines. Now, there's a little story I can tell you.
Good. Let's hear one.
The first submarine I went out on at sub school was a Diablo. And my first dive on a submarine, I was in the engine room with two or three other schoolboys. And we went out and they pulled the plug or submerged. And one of the things you have to do is trip the engine air induction, which they have a main induction valve which sucks air in and comes outside the hull and then comes into the hull, and it's got a flapper valve on that induction to keep water from coming in the boat. And then you have to crank the inboard exhaust valve shut. 33 1/3 turns, that big old hand wheel cranking that inboard engine exhaust valve shut. Well, we got ready to surface, and we had to open the exhaust valves. And then they showed us how to open the flapper valve. It has a big lever on it. Then the engineman told us to stand right there between the engines, under that engine air induction.
And I know where this is going.
What they knew and what we didn't know is that there was a leak in that engine air induction line where it came down and then roached up to come down through the hull. Well, that water was in that belly of that pipe, in that low spot. Everything was fine till they got ready to surface. When the boat took an up angle, it unloaded about 30 or 40 gallons of that ice-cold water from Block Island Sound right on us schoolboys. We didn't know what to do. You know, instantly, you're scared. And then you look up and see those engineers up there about to die laughing. You know you've been had.
Welcome to my initiation.
So that was my very first dive on a submarine, and I still stayed. And that wasn't enough to drive me off, but that was the little trick that they played. But my first submarine after I left, sub school was USS Redfish. And she was at Hunters Point Naval Shipyard, San Francisco. And I reported aboard and the first day of March of 1956. And I took a tour. I went up and looked at the boat. And the first thing, went up on the dry dock and looked down. And I could see right through the hull to the aft torpedo tubes. They'd cut a section of the hull out that they were placing right at the water line. And as luck would have it, about 2 days later, they were getting ready to replace that piece of hull plate, which is about 18 inches high and 6 feet long. It's just a strip there. And they sent me down on fire watch. Well, while the boat was in the dry dock, there was still water in the bilge under the torpedo tubes. There was oil in the bilge floating on the water. and there was also cork, because the inside of the hull is lined with 1 inch of cork to keep the hull from sweating, you know, keep the condensation from forming on the hull. So where they'd torn all that cork off, a lot of that was floating around in the bilge. Well, they set that piece of hull plate up there, and I'm down inside the torpedo room. I'm the only one there. Luckily, I had 8 or 9 fire extinguishers sitting there. And the guy started with a burning torch to fit that plate, to make it fit. Those sparks were coming right through and going right into that bilge around the torpedo tubes. And with that cork there acting like wicks, it was setting fires. I was hollering, trying to get him to stop. Whatever, the guy's up there burning away. He couldn't hear me. There's nobody else in the room. And I'm putting out fires and hollering and trying to throw things up to get his attention. And luckily, he finished burning as I went out of my last fire extinguisher.
What an experience that must have been.
Yeah, for an 18-year-old kid. You know, just...
I'm not even, I'm going to die on the surface in a submarine and on fire of all things.
But luckily, that didn't happen. And I went up and we caused some changes to be made with the shipyard force to preclude any further occurrences of that type of thing. When you go aboard a submarine on those old boats, you normally had 6 months to qualify. And my qualification didn't, since we were in the Navy Yard, my qualification didn't start until we left the Navy Yard. So I actually started on the first day of July was my qual start date. So I had the rest of the year to qualify. In order to qualify on those old boats, you had to know every man's job. You had to know every system. You had to be able to draw it all on a piece of paper if somebody asked you. You had to be able to put your hand on every valve, operate every piece of equipment. Cooks had to be able to fire torpedoes or light off a main engine. It didn't matter. In order to earn your Dolphins, you have to know everything. You have to know all of the tank arrangements, the whole bit.
Mr. Harvey, can we stop you right there? Because we've got to take a little short break. We're going to come back and find out more about this interesting story from Mr. C.L. Harvey and his submarine experience. Don't go away. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Local Heroes here on WKFK TV7. Tonight we're talking to Mr. C.L. Harvey about his experience in the United States Navy, more particularly the undersea service of the submarines. And Mr. Harvey, before we went to the break, you were talking about all the qualifications and all the stuff you had to learn in order to earn your Dolphins. And unfortunately, the break interrupted us. So can you continue on with that and tell us some of the things you had to learn and why?
Well, submarine crews are, those old boats had about 75 men in the crew. And that can, you can end up shorthanded easily if you have a few men injured, or even during peacetime you have people going on leave and all. But you had to be able to take any other man's job. In fact, I've stood watches in the after torpedo room underway. I had nothing to do with torpedoes in any of the jobs I did, but I could stand a watch in the torpedo room because I knew what went on back there. It's damage control. No matter who is there, they know what to do if you have a casualty, if you have a leak. I can tell you one interesting story about a little leak. One day we were on daily ops when I was on the Redfish. We were out of San Diego. And 5 waves from the Naval District had gotten permission to ride a submarine to sea for one day. So since we were on daily ops, we got selected.
Now that's a woman.
A wave woman is a female sailor.
A woman accepted for voluntary emergency service. Okay.
But anyhow, we had these 5 waves. And they were sitting in the mess hall. They'd had their tour of the boat and all, and we were running target for sonar school destroyers or something. So we were down at about 200 feet, just cruising along, just doing nothing. I just happened to walk in for a cup of coffee. The five waves were sitting around a forward mess table outboard, and the mess cook was sitting at the after table peeling potatoes. All of a sudden, there's a noise. You hear a boing, type noise. And he reached down and opened the locker. There's a safety flood valve operating gear there. And when he did, a stream of water about the size of a pencil shot across the mess hall and hit the hull right above the scullery sink and bounced down into the sink. Those waves started screaming and hollering, and they didn't stop till they got to the forward torpedo room where they knew there was an escape hatch up there.
But they're 200 feet under the water.
Yeah, but they just squealed and ran. Well, what it was, a grease fitting, had zerk fitting, had popped out, and the water had pushed the grease out of that line, and seawater was coming in from that external grease fitting and shooting across the compartment. And as luck would have it, it just hit the hull and bounced right down into the sink where the mess cooks washed the dishes. And they reported it, and it was a 10-minute fix for the auxiliary to come back and screw a new zerk fitting in it and pop it full of grease and go on. But that was funny. I mean, I have never seen five women squeal any louder in my life. That was a funny thing.
But, you know, you're 200 feet under the water, and you've never been there before, and it's a leak.
It's
scary to death.
so that was fun. One interesting thing that happened while I was on the Redfish is we were selected to make the movie Run Silent, Run Deep, which starred Clark Gable and Burt Lancaster. And they were both aboard for a while, and that was interesting. Paid well, too. I got a $10 bill, a 50-cent cigar in a glass tube, and an autographed picture of Burt Lancaster and Clark Gable and Burt Lancaster's signature on ship's letterhead stationery.
That was great pay. What did you do with that 10 whole dollars you got there, Mr. Harvey?
That was 1957, I guess, that we made that movie. And
how long did that take? How long were they on board ship?
They weren't actually, Gable and Lancaster weren't aboard that much. They rode us to sea for 2 days. Most of their internal shots were made aboard a reserve submarine that was tied up, and they made their internal shots there. We just made the at-sea shots. It was at the time I had a convoluted service. I was an electronics technician striker, which is what they call it. I was a seaman, E3. But when I reported aboard the Redfish in the Navy Yard, the guy that was leading seaman, we had a first class gunner's mate that was charge of the deck force, but the guy that was leading seaman under him, or, you know, running the deck force under Gunner Howe, opened a 900-foot coil of 5-inch manila line, about that big around, mooring lines, and he pulled it out of the wrong end so that every coil had a kink. 900 feet of that heavy rope had a kink. And Gunner was absolutely livid. He was mad. And he asked me if I knew what Brownie had done wrong. And I told him, yeah, he pulled a rope out of the wrong end of the coil. So it took probably 4 or 5 hours to get those kinks out of that 900 foot. Well, then he asked me if I could put splices in that mooring line. And I said, yes. So we cut it up into the appropriate lengths, and I used a FID, which is another strange name to people that don't know. It's a conical piece of wood about that high, comes to a sharp point. You can take that heavy line and force it down over it so you can put the strands through to make your splice, your eye splice. So I knew how to do that. So I became leading seaman. Well, not long after we left the Navy Yard, Gunner Howell retired. He was a World War II sailor. And I ended up running the deck force. Now, here I was, electronics. I stood some lookout and helms watches, but then I went to the standard radar and sonar watches. But I was still maneuvering watch helmsman because I was the top helmsman on board battle stations and maneuvering going in and out of port. I had the helm, even though I didn't stand them underway.
Tell folks at home exactly what that job entailed. What's the helmsman do?
Well, he steers the ship. But you can't see where you're going. You have to steer by compass. But you also have the controls, the motor order telegraphs to send signals back to the maneuvering room for speed changes, whether one-third or two-thirds ahead or one-third or astern or whatever.
Right, you don't have your foot on the accelerator pedal.
No,
you're just not looking out a windshield when you're doing
it. No, you're looking at a compass. You're steering by compass and taking order commands from the bridge when you're on the surface and from the conning officer in the conning tower while you're submerged. But you're steering by compass, and all the speed controls are just sent back to maneuvering so that they can answer them and do what's necessary speed-wise.
So when you send a control back, there's an answer, which means you're connected somehow to them, and there's an answer that comes back that says they are at what you
asked. Right. When your enunciators have a dial on them, and if they say all ahead two-thirds, you say all ahead two-thirds, you ring up two-thirds, maneuvering answers, and you report back answers all ahead two-thirds, report to the bridge so that they know that their command has been obeyed.
Okay.
So that was, anyhow, I ended up running the deck force all the time I was on the Redfish.
Now, the deck force are the people who actually do what? On deck?
I had to take care of all the mooring lines. All of the painting topside was done.
Chipping and painting.
All the guys that did that were working for me. And I remember one day we were swinging around a buoy instead of being tied alongside the tender as we normally were. And I painted the Redfish from bow to stern, from the water line to the top of the periscope shears in one day.
You and your crew, or just you?
I was the one on the spray gun, and I had three seamen helping me. We had acquired an extra paint pot, 5-gallon paint pot. So I'd have two of the guys mixing and straining paint and fixing up a paint pot, while one of the guys was lugging the paint pot around and I was on the spray gun. When that pot had run empty, we'd just go back, get the other pot, put the lid on it, go again. And we painted that boat in one day.
Wow, that's a pretty good feat. How long was it?
312 feet.
312 feet and?
27 feet wide.
That's a job, you did it in one day. Amazing.
Yeah, it's...
What possessed you, Mr. Harvey, to want to be on submarines? They're underneath the water for days.
One of the main things that really intrigued me is that was still a dungaree navy, which means that you did not have to put on a uniform to go eat chow like you did on the surface crafts. After working hours, you didn't have to go put on your undress blues or your undress whites to look sharp. You lived in your dungarees, which were kind of like blue jeans and a light blue chambray shirt. And just having talked to submarine sailors while I was at boot camp and how they liked it. You know, we got to talk to people from all over the Navy, and they just intrigued me, and I decided that's what I want to do.
Well, unfortunately, we run out of time for this show. We're going to bring you back again because your story is so interesting, and we all want to hear more. So, don't forget, next Local Heroes, we'll have more with Mr. C.L. Harvey talking about his Navy and submarine service. So join us next week for more of this interesting story. Here on Local Heroes, WKFK TV 7. Thank you for watching.